us some bread.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Okay.
Well, go along with kind of that theme. Yeshua said that if any child among you asks for a piece of bread, will you give him a stone? Mm-hmm. Okay. So we're going to give out some bread today. Hallelujah.
All right.
We're picking up where we left off last time in the book of Romans. The book of Romans, chapter 7. We got through verse 5. We're going to pick up in verse 6. And that's probably about as far as the book goes. Because there's a lot to glean from just in verse 6 alone. Okay? Let's pray and ask the Lord's blessing upon our ears, upon our hearts, upon His Word. And that the Holy Spirit would move upon us. All right, let's read verses 5 and 6, and we'll pray Lord's blessing upon it, and we'll break open verse 6. For when we were in the flesh, the passions of sins, plurality, which were aroused by the law, were at work in our members to bear fruit unto death. But now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by, so that we should serve in the newness of the Spirit and not in the oldness of the letter. Hallelujah. Father, we thank you again for blessing this word to us, this word of truth, in Yeshua's holy name. Let that anointing, hallelujah, break every yoke of bondage and let the seed of your word hit the mark, hit the heart. Not returning unto you void or empty, but accomplishing the very things that you have purposed and destined to accomplish in every heart, every life. Father, you know us so much, know us through and through. You always have our best interests in your heart and mind. And we thank you that you are continually setting us up to succeed, never to fail. And Father, we ask you that you open the eyes, hallelujah, of our understanding. And again, that we would have ears to hear what Ruach HaKodesh has to say to us individually, today and corporately as the body of Christ. Yeshua's holy name, we thank you for the privileged honor. Amen and amen. All glory to you.
All
hallelujah,
right.
Hallelujah. Now, verse 6, it says, but now we have been delivered from the law. But we are not delivered in the sense that you may think, not in the freedom to do what the law forbids. All right? So if the law forbids, if God's laws and commands forbid us in certain activity and lifestyle, we must obey. But what literally are we free from the law? We are free from the spiritual liabilities and the penalties of God's law, specifically condemnation.
Yes.
Specifically condemnation. Yeah. Let's turn to Galatians chapter 3, verse 13 for a minute. And take a quick peek. Hallelujah, to help us see a little bit more clearly. Galatians 3 and verse 13. 13a, but we'll read probably 13 and 14. All right, let's go back up to verse 10.
Where?
Galatians chapter 3, we'll read verse 10, but I want you to focus on verse 13. For as many as are of the works of the law are under the curse. For it is written, cursed is everyone who does not continue in all things which are written in the book of the law and then do them. Come on, somebody. We're free from that curse. Glory. Verse 11. But that no one is justified by the law in the sight of Yahweh is evident, for the just shall live by faith. If the law is not of faith, but yet the law is not of faith, but the man who does them shall live by them. Verse 13. Christ has redeemed us from the curse of the law, having become a curse for us, for it is written, curses everyone who hangs on a tree. Verse 14, that the blessings of Abraham might come upon the Gentiles and Mashiach, and that we might receive the promise of the Spirit through faith. He's talking about conversion. He's talking about a regeneration process. He's talking about the curse of the law being broken over us. Hallelujah. And we're going to see back in verse 6 that because we have died, hallelujah, we are free from that condemnation. We are free from the curse. We have died so we can live. It's tough. Romans 7 and 8 are all of Romans in the flesh and the carnal mindset or in the Gentile mindset can be hard to understand. But I'm so thankful that we see clearly by the Spirit and we come to an understanding. Going back to verse 6 in chapter 7 of Romans, but now we have been delivered from the law, having died to what we were held by. How did we die? And what were we held by? Because we have literally died in Christ when He died. Because of our conversion process, because of repentance, and because of going down into the waters of immersion to be born anew and to be filled and sealed with His Holy Spirit, we literally go down into the waters of baptism to die, if you will. And so because we have died in Christ and through the conversion process, hallelujah, the law with its condemnation and penalties no longer have jurisdiction over us.
Amen.
Well, that's big. That's big. Let's go back up to verse 4 for a minute and re-examine that. Therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead. Glory to God. That's what we just talked about. And part of the testimony of going down into the waters of immersion is we testify that I'm willing to die to myself, to the old man, that Adamic nature, to the flesh. And what we mean by the flesh and what the Bible means by the flesh is one who is alienated from the life of Christ.
Amen.
One who is in the flesh, separate from the true light, from the true word, from the opportunity to have eternal life. And so part of our testimony is, Lord, I'm willing to die to that lifestyle. I'm changing my stinking thinking. I'm repenting in my mind and I'm repenting in my life and I'm turning away from and I'm turning to and I'm willing to go down into the waters of baptism to be associated with Christ's death, burial, and then His resurrection. Hallelujah. Amen. I am willing to die to myself and embrace the death of Christ. What was accomplished at the cross of Calvary. For truly it was finished. He went into the tomb and He came forth from the tomb to die no more. He is resurrected, and the Bible says that in Him we now live a resurrected life in Christ.
Yes.
So we are now alive and well after we have died, if you will. Therefore, my brethren, you also have become dead to the law through the body of Christ. See, if we're in Christ and associated to the messianic body of Yeshua HaMashiach, Jesus, the true Messiah, then we have truly died to those things. That you then now may be married. You know, Derek was talking about the season of understanding the marriage. Hallelujah. And so he says that because there was a death, we have been separated from the law. Because the law says in verses 1 through 3, we know the law covers those things as long as our spouse is alive. But because that spouse dies, we are from the law free. We are free from the law of marriage, and then we are not an adulterer or an adulteress. But because of us, as an example, hallelujah, we have literally died. We've gone in, and now we are free to enter this marriage relationship with Yeshua HaMashiach and to embrace such a loving Father. that you now may be married to another, even to him who was raised from the dead, that we should bear fruit unto Yahweh. Fruit unto Yahweh. Because if we're in the flesh, verse 5, we're going to bear fruit unto death. These things are setting up chapter 8 to help us understand what he goes on to say about no condemnation any longer and the rest of Romans chapter 8. But we are free, my friends, to marry another because a death came and separated us from the condemnation of the law. If we're in Christ and in his resurrected body, glory to God. I'm excited about that. So we needed to talk about that a little bit. We're going to labor that for a minute. So let's go back to the book of 1 John, the Epistle of John, chapter 1, James, Peter, John. Hallelujah. Some of these saints are going to be a little meaty, but that's all right. We're going to give you some milk to wash that down with, glory to God. Stir you and provoke you to study on your own, to be a Berean, to look at these things, to come to an understanding and allow the Holy Spirit then to guide you. This is kind of an overflow of where we're going. You know, let me share this to help bring us to a better understanding and perspective. After we have died, in verse 6 of Romans 7, we have died to what we were held by in the flesh, if you will. Alright? But now, we should serve in the newness of the life of the Spirit. And this is important. This word serve, literally, is taken from the vowel or the word bond servant or bond slave. Wow. That's pretty heavy, pretty meaty. So now we are bound, amen, as servants to live in the newness of the Spirit. I wanted to share this, to share, hallelujah, the epistle of John, chapter 3. And I'll bring more explanation as we look at some more scripture and more clarity. Let's look at verses 4 through 10.
Is that John 3, Pastor?
Yes. And let me share this while we're preparing to read from this epistle. That when our heart is captured by the King and we are regenerated, and he comes in us in his fullness, like the Bible describes, that we are radically changed. We're no longer a caterpillar on the floor or on the ground crawling, but we are now a butterfly in Christ. We have died to that lifestyle and that condition to be born anew in the resurrected life. Amen?
Amen.
And so because of that, and because we are now servants and literally bond slaves, and what we'll see, hallelujah, that in the Spirit that brings freedom. In the natural mind, you're saying, oh, I'm not going to be a bond slave to nobody. And that's the real issue. It's the Lordship, Adonai, of Yeshua HaMashiach. People want to go to heaven. I'm going to share this till I give up the ghost. People want to go to heaven when they die. They want to embrace salvation. That's just a given. That's just a given. But when you say you have to sell out and embrace, we don't make him Lord, he's already Lord. We just embrace the totality of his Lordship. And then we freely come under that Lordship of our life. We don't have a problem with embracing him to go to heaven. But where the real issue is, he wants to be Lord of our life. He is and needs to be Lord of our life. And because of that, we become his servant. And in that relationship, you cannot stay in the flesh. In that relationship, you cannot continue to sin. You cannot. Don't take my word for it, just take the word of the Lord. Hallelujah. Amen. Let's begin to read and we'll expound on this a little bit because it's a point that needs to be driven home. We're talking about radical change. We're talking about regeneration. We're talking about, you know it, your husband knows it, your wife knows it, your children know it, your neighbor knows it, God knows it, your boss knows it, your fellow employees know it. Hallelujah. The devil knows it. Hallelujah. That we are radically changed. That we are in Christ's likeness now. This is a regeneration. Total radical change. Verse 4. Whoever commits sin also commits lawlessness. And sin is lawlessness. That's just flat out what it is. And you know, verse 5. That he, Christ, was manifested to take away our sins, plurality. And in him there is no sin. Whoever abides in him, and this word abide means whoever dwells, whoever has made their home, their abode, and vice versa. Whoever abides in him, dwells, stays, lives there, does not sin. Wow, that's big. That's the truth. If we're in Christ and he is in us, it's impossible to continually sin. That's why I don't always like these testimonies. Oh, bless God. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. Hallelujah. Well, you know what? That may be true, but what are you saying in that? You know? I just continue to sin. Well, wait. The Bible says in Christ we don't continue to sin. In Christ there is no sin, because we died to sin. Hallelujah. We died to condemnation. We died to the law. We're resurrected in the newness of life.
Amen.
That's what he's saying right here. This is radical, but it's true. I'm just a worm. I'm just a no good. I can't help myself. I'm just a sinner saved by grace. I sin all the time. Now wait. What's wrong with that testimony? What's wrong with that profession? Whoever abides, verse 6, and dwells in him does not sin. Whoever sins has neither seen him nor known him. That's heavy duty. That's heavy duty, but it's none the truth. Nonetheless, the truth. Verse 7. Little children, or literally Christian converts, converted ones, let no one deceive you. He who practices righteousness, this is righteous, just as he, Yeshua, is righteous. Don't be deceived. Either you're in or you're out. Either you're sanctified or you're not. Either you're walking in a sinless life or you're not. Either you're in the flesh or you're in the spirit.
Hallelujah.
What I mean by in the flesh, you're outside of Christ. In the flesh. Come on. That's what the Bible means. Verse 8. Let's take it a little farther. This is radical. He who sins, plurality, is of the devil. For the devil has sinned from the beginning. For this purpose, the Son of God was manifested, that he might destroy the works of the devil. Either he did or he didn't. Verse 9. Whoever has been born again of Yahweh does not sin. There it is. For his, God's seed remains in him. And as we have opened up and entered into this intimate relationship, God has come in. His seed is here within us. So what is he saying? We as Christians are equipped to do good. Alright? He has equipped us to do good. And as we serve him as a bondservant, that's the only choice we have, is then to do good. You don't have any other option. You really don't. He's equipped us to do good, and guess what? You will do good in every circumstance and situation. You will slap the flesh down because that's in you. That's God's nature in you. That's God's seed in you. You will say no to the flesh, right? Because that's in you. When you have the opportunity to lie, you'll tell the truth. When you have the opportunity to cheat or steal, you will not steal. Hallelujah. You will not cheat. When you have opportunity to be a peacemaker, you will be a peacemaker because that's the nature of God in you. You cannot go contrary unless you want to totally rebel against God and the nature that is in you. Wow. We really don't have a dual nature. We really don't. We have the flesh that we battle with, but the nature we have in us now as Christians is God. The fullness. The Bible says, of His fullness we have received. We lack nothing in Him. He's given us all things. Even the faith. Hallelujah, to believe. By God's grace, He's allowed us to come to this place of victory in and through Him. Oh, I just can't help myself. Well, you know what? What does the Word say? What does the Word working life in your life say? His seed remains in us. Hallelujah. This is what we've been impregnated with. This is what we give birth to. Because His seed remains in us, He cannot sin. If God is in you, you cannot sin. Whoa, 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 whoa. Wow, that's just blowing my religious mindset all over the place. But it's nonetheless the truth. Who's calling me when I'm in the middle of preaching? Come on. This happens every now and again. If God's seed is in us, you cannot sin. Why? Because He has been born of God. If you've died to self and to the world, you've been reborn, you've established a new birth through the conversion process, you are now born again. Come on. You've been born from above, born spiritually. You've been born of your Heavenly Father, Yahweh. Come on, somebody. Yes. And so you cannot sin. Wow, that's interesting. Verse 10 drives it home. Here's the nail in the coffin. In this, the children of Yahweh and the children of the devil are made manifest. The light is on the subject. There's no gray area here. It's black and it's white. It's dark and it's light. Come on, somebody. Right. Here it is. In this, the children of Yahweh and the children of the devil are made manifest. It's exposed. It's light. It's right here. Whoever does not practice righteousness is not of God, nor is he who does not agape his brother. Look at verse 11. But this is the message you heard from the beginning. Wow. Wow. You know what's so exciting and so sad? Let's go to 1 Peter for a minute. Because this is just messing you up. Now remember what we just shared. In Christ there is no condemnation. That's what chapter 8 of the book of Romans is talking about. There is now, therefore, no condemnation to those who live godly in Christ. So don't sit here and beat yourself up like, oh, I must not be saved, man, because I had this and I had that. And I'm just telling you what the gospel message is here. Let's go to Peter, 1 Peter again, and let's look at some of my favorite scriptures. This is what we need to feast on. This is the word we need to give forth, and this is what people need to hear and how we need to come into conversion. We don't need a watered-down gospel. We don't need an easy believism gospel. We need the absolute truth, and we need the word to cut you and slice you and dice you. That's what it's meant to do. It's supposed to flay you wide open. It's supposed to operate on you and go deep and even discernment between the innermost of your being, between the soul and the spirit of man. In verse 22, chapter 1 of 1 Peter, since you have purified your souls in obeying the truth. This is big, this is meaty, this is no small things. Since you have purified your own souls by obeying the truth, through the spirit and sincere agape of the brethren, agape one another, love each other unconditionally, fervently with a pure heart. We can love each other fervently with a pure heart. There can be a definite sign of agape in your life because 1 John 4:7 and 8 tells us that love is God, God is love. Agape love. If we don't have love, we don't have God. Because God is love. And if Yahweh has come in us and all of our, His fullness, we have agape love living and residing in us. We've been impregnated with that. We just have to give birth to it. Now again, we can't be what we're not. We can't take nobody where we've never been. If we don't have it, we can't give it. Come on, somebody. I love this context. It's so meaty, it's so freeing. If we look at verse 23 in that same chapter, you having been born anew, born again, born from above, spiritual rebirth, you have been born again out of corruptible seed. God's word is the seed. The gospel in purity is the seed going forth. We need to preach the gospel Yeshua told us and commanded us to preach. Not the denominationalized gospel. Not a watered down version. Not pick and choose what we want to do and say and hear. They have been born again not of corruptible seed, not of adulterated seed, but the pure seed of God's word that brings true conviction. When we come to the point where we say, man, I'm a man or a woman undone, I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired, I'm sick and tired of being alienated from what is good, I need a Savior. I need to be saved. And there's only one place to go, and that's the cross. That's the Christ. That's His ultimate sacrifice. And when we die through conversion and immersion, and when we're resurrected to newness of life, we are resurrected in Christ. Christ isn't going to die again. We don't have to die again that way. We can be born twice to die once, my friends. It's your choice. Or you can be born once to die twice. That's your choice. You hear me share it all the time. We can be born once physically, spiritually reborn from above, to die once physically, and then have eternal life. Forever and ever. Or you can be born once, say, humbug, I'm going to resist Christ. I'm going to be a Christ rejecter. I'm going to reject His way and go my way, my thoughts, my plans, my desires. And you can die physically and then experience eternal death through the lake of fire, which is your second death. You choose. But see here, the apostle by the Spirit is telling his hearers, you have been born again, not of corruptible seed, but incorruptible, through the word of Yahweh, which lives and abides forever.
Amen.
Because all flesh is like the grass, and all the glory of man is like the flower of the grass. Oh, my friends, don't be deceived, for the grass will wither, and the flower will fall away. But the word of Yahweh endures forever. Taken out of Isaiah 40 verse 5. And he concludes with this. Now this is the word which by the gospel was preached unto you. My friends, it's a very narrow-minded way. It's a difficult way. The message, it is hard, even though it's good. Narrow is the way, Christ even said, and very few will find it. Broad is the way that leads to destruction, and most will find that way. Everybody wants to die and go to heaven. Not an issue. Not everybody wants to submit to the Father's righteous requirements of how to be converted and to the Lordship of Yeshua HaMashiach. Oh, I don't want anybody running my life. I've heard people say, well, you know, I know what you're saying. It's like my grandson a couple weeks ago, where he's been working in the wood since he's been a year and a half in diapers. So we're working in the wood, and cute as a bug, he goes, Papa, I'm always going to work with you. I'm always going to help you. And he said that about 15 times over about 15 minutes. But I would explain something to him about the wood, and he goes, Papa, I understand what you're saying. He's 3 years old. And he calls me Papa Keith. Papa Keith, I know exactly what you're saying. Papa Keith, I'm always going to help you. I'm going to work with you in the wood, Papa Keith. Christians, I've talked to people and they said, I hear you, I know what you're saying, but I'm going my own way in this. Oh. Lord, are you kidding me right now? An under shepherd of the Lord, a minister of God trying to speak wisdom into the life of a person. Yeah, I understand what you're saying and I see it, but you know what? The ways of Christ are the ways of Christianity. In this matter, I'm going my own way, Pastor Keith. I hear you, Pastor Keith. I'm going to do my own thing. Go ahead on, man. Go ahead on. That's why we don't like the council. The best counseling we can give is right here on a Sunday morning, sitting under the Word of God and the Holy Spirit, touching the heart of every man down here. That's the best counseling you can get. Or when you break open the Word yourself. And you know what's cool about that? We got the Holy Ghost. Are you kidding me right now? You are not convicted by the Holy Spirit of this word of truth that we're just speaking knowledge right into your life? No, because I don't want to submit to you. I don't want to submit to the Lordship of Christ. I want to die and go to heaven, but I'm going to do my own thing here because I'm going to follow after the flesh. Wow, that's a scary place to be. That is flat out rebellion. I'm telling you right out, straight up, that's rebellion. Against God, against His Spirit, against His Word, against teaching and influence in your life, against the Word of knowledge and wisdom. Hallelujah. That's flat out rebellion. Oh, we agape you. We agape the Lord. We agape one and all you do. Oh, okay, cool. So when we are in Christ and He's in us, we cannot sin. Because we are now bound to serve the new life in the Spirit. Wow, have you ever heard that put that way before? Huh? Anybody? Say amen if you ever heard that before.
Amen.
Don't tell me this is the first time you ever heard this in your adult Christian life, right? Hallelujah. Well, praise ye the Lord. Let's go back to Romans chapter 1, verse 1. Amen. We'll keep track of time, but look what Paul's profession of faith is. Look what he confesses. I, Paul, a servant, literally in the original language, a bondservant, a slave to Yeshua HaMashiach. Shaul have lost my earthly identity. I've taken on the identity of Christ. I'm being conformed and have been conformed to His very image. And that I used to be. Arresting Christians, beating Christians, taking Christians out of their home, killing Christians, attacking the church, attacking the body of Mashiach. That's not me anymore. I've died to that life. I have a new identity in Christ. I have a new name. Hallelujah. And now I am a servant of Yeshua HaMashiach. I've been called to be an apostle, separated until the gospel of Yahweh. Amen. Wow. 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 Let's go to chapter 6, if you will.
Romans
chapter 6, verses 18, 19, and 22. And Shaul says, and having been set free from sin, you have become slaves unto righteousness. What are we bound to? What are we a slave to? Righteousness. Sister Janet was exhorting us on righteousness this morning. I speak in human terms because the weakness of your own flesh. For just as you presented your members as slaves, as uncleanness, and of lawlessness leading to more lawlessness. So now present all your members, your whole body, soul, and spirit, as slaves of righteousness, yea, unto Kodesh, holiness.
Awesome.
But now, having been free, verse 22, from sin, having become slaves unto Yahweh, bondservant, slave. You have your fruit to holiness. And the end brings everlasting life. The message today in the liberal realm, slavery is gone. In that sense, absolutely. But in the life of the Christian, it's here as well as how we live. And in the spirit, that's freedom. In the natural mind, oh, I can't figure that out. That sounds like bondage to me. That sounds like God puts these people in a square and they're bound. No. I'm free. You're bound. You try to explain that to somebody. Let me help you here. They're not going to get it. Why won't they get it? You'll hear this again soon. Let's turn to 1 Corinthians chapter 2. Look at verses 12 through 15. Powerful statement and words. Now we have received not the spirit of the world, the Ruach, the Holy Spirit who is from Yahweh, that we might know the things that have been freely given to us by our Heavenly Father, Abba. Verse 13, these things we also speak, not in words which man's wisdom teaches, but which the Holy Spirit, Ruach HaKodesh, the Holy Spirit teaches, our Paracletus, our Counselor, our Guide, comparing spiritual things with spiritual things. But the natural-minded, the fleshly, the carnal-minded man does not receive, nor does he understand or discern spiritual things, the Spirit of Yahweh. For they are even foolishness unto him, nor can he know them because they are spiritually discerned. We who are spiritually enlightened understand with great knowledge and understanding how to walk in these ways. When the Spirit speaks, we connect, we know. Like Derek said, even driving his truck, the Spirit can speak in certain ways to bring confirmation, words of knowledge and wisdom. This is the life we now have in Christ. The natural-minded people, the fleshly, carnal-minded people won't get the spiritual application and your spiritual life. They can't discern it. They won't understand it. To them, it's foolishness. You go home and tell everybody, you know, I am a bond slave. Hallelujah, I'm free. I'm a bond slave. You go tell that to your neighbor. I'm a bond slave to Yeshua HaMashiach. I am a servant of the Most High God, El-El-Yar. They'll think, are you crazy? I have somebody, the Lord's over my life. I have embraced his lordship. I am his servant. He's a king. I don't even get a vote in this relationship. Go tell that to your neighbor. Come on, somebody. That's not my way. It's his way. It's not what I want to do. It's what he calls us to do. It goes on to say that in verse 15, but he who is spiritual discerns and judges all things. Yet he himself then is rightly judged by no one. That's interesting. Let's jump back to 1 Kepha. Hallelujah, Peter. Back to chapter 1 in 1 Peter. Picking it up in verse 17. And it's in the context of what we just read from verses 22 through 25, but by the Spirit, Kepha says this, and if you call on the Father, who without partiality judges according to each one's work, conduct yourselves throughout the time of your sojourning here in fear. We're strangers in a foreign land, we're just passing through, conduct your passing through in great fear. You go figure that one out.
Wow.
Are we to fear devils? Heck no. Are we to fear Satan? Heck no. Who do we fear? Who do we respect? We should fear sin. Hallelujah. We don't sin. We don't want to sin. We don't want to go near that great God. Verse 18. Very meaty. Knowing that you were redeemed. You were not redeemed with corruptible things like silver or gold. From your aimless conduct. In the flesh, we were aimless. We had conduct on what? Becoming. Hallelujah. It's a military term. But nonetheless, we had conduct unbecoming to our superior officer and to the army of God. Hallelujah. But now that we're in, praise God. We were We're not bought and redeemed with corruptible things from our aimless conduct, from our life in the flesh, received from traditions of men, from our fathers. These are perishable things. But you have been purchased with the precious blood of Yeshua HaMashiach as a lamb without blemish and without spot.
Amen.
See, my friends, we're no longer our own anymore. We've been bought. We've been purchased. And so when we, let me help you here. When we share the gospel, don't try to twist somebody's arm to be saved, although I'd love to. It's got to be by the Spirit.
Yeah.
We can't force it. We can't manipulate.
Nope.
I mean, I could stand up here Sunday after Sunday and manipulate people and get to the altar by working on their feelings and emotions and saying the right things at the right time. No. It's got to come by direct, conviction right here.
Mm-hmm.
Direct conviction. People have to be broken. Hallelujah. Sick and tired of being sick and tired. So we have to be careful even when we're out evangelizing. We got to bring the word, man. There has to be true fruits of repentance. What did John the prophet, the immerser, say? He saw the religious people coming down, and we found out a little bit more about that group on Wednesday night. But he goes, who warned you of the coming judgment? Wow. Hey, fellas, go show me fruits of repentance first before I immerse you. Then come back, boys, when you got fruits of true conversion, true repentance, and I'll put you down in the waters. Hallelujah. That's why sometimes it's good to see true fruits of repentance, and then we take that next step. People get to the point of being broken. You can't make it too easy for people. Come on. Because it's not an easy way. It's a difficult way. It's not a way that I've made. I'm not trying to make it difficult. I'm just sharing with you all the truth and the truth of the gospel. And today for us, the things we battle again is the Greek mindset and the traditions of men. That's what we battle in the church today because we've heard it all. We've seen it all. It's not a watered-down gospel. It cuts you, man. It's sharper than any two-edged sword. It will pierce you. But when we come to the place where we're willing to say, man, I'm a man undone, and I need to be saved. I need a Savior. God saved me from myself in this perverse generation, and He took away the fear of hell from my heart. Those are the things that drove me to the cross. I looked in the mirror and I said, I can't do it. I can't make my own way. I can't take no drug, no alcohol, no drug of choice to cover up my void, my emptiness. I need to be saved. I need to be saved from myself because I'm heading to destruction. I will kill myself prematurely by ignorance. Come on, somebody.
All right.
I need to be saved. And there's only one place I know I can go, and that's to the cross. I'm going to embrace Christ. And when we, by faith, grab Him, and a miracle takes place, and we go through that process of conversion, when we go, we have to go down in the waters of immersion, man. I'm telling you. And when we come up, and we get sealed and filled with the Holy Ghost, look out, somebody. We are changed forever. Ladies and gentlemen, it's tough, but it's good.
Yeah.
And the natural-minded, it seems like crazy, but to us who spiritually discern and understand, bears witness and testimony. We've got to chew this up like a cow, man, if you will. We've got to swallow it down, bring it back up, chew on it a while, think about it, swallow it back down, bring it back up. There are things that I've literally been studying for 30 years that I'm even now today getting new revelation on.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Man, oh man, God is good and the Holy Spirit is awesome. If you have a hunger for true bread, you will be satisfied. You will be fed. But look at here, saints. For the mindset that says, yes, I want to be saved and go to heaven, but I want to live my own life and still reap the benefits of being a Christian. Dangerous. Very dangerous.
Yeah.
Very deceptive. We have to come to the place, yeah, I'm willing to go through great exchange right here, my life for yours. I'm willing to give it all. I'm willing to die. I'm willing to come back to life in Christ. I'm willing to serve Him. Now, if we're habitually living in sin and being rebellious to God's ways, I don't know, go search the scriptures. There's many more scriptures other than 1 John, but that's the most black and white one. Lays it all out, fillets it right here. Here's God's team, here's the devil's team. This is what God says about sin. Sins. You can't play the game and go do your own thing.
Right.
This doesn't work. He says, get off the fence. Get out of your lukewarmness. Yes. Get hot.
Good.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
Good.
Because you know what? That lifestyle makes me vomit. The Bible says he will vomit, spit you out of his mouth. A lukewarm life will cause the Lord unnecessary grief and heartache. I'll give you some more scripture as tools to help you here. You know, 1 John told us there's no way we can continually, habitually stay in sin. There's no way. It's impossible. If we're truly saved and converted. And here's some help for us. Alright? And if we do stumble, if we do make a mistake, if we do sin and rebel for a minute, the Holy Spirit in us will quicken us immediately. And will in Christ will do His will. His perfect predestined will. There's no way, if Christ is resident here, there's no way that we can habitually, continually stay in sinful misconduct. No way. It's impossible. 1 John chapter 1, verses 8, 9, 10, down into chapter 2, verses 1 and 2. So Will says this, if we say we have no sin, we deceive ourselves and the truth is not in us. If we confess our sins, plurality, He is faithful and just to forgive us of our sins and then to cleanse us from all unrighteousness. If we say that we have not sinned, we make Him a liar and His word is not in us. Alright, now there's B.C. before Christ and A.D. after Christ. Chapter 2, verse 1. My little children, He's converted ones. In the original language, my little children, converted ones, converted Christians, regenerated Christians. These things I write to you, that you may not sin. It shouldn't be norm. It shouldn't be what we're used to. That you may not sin. And if anyone sins, He says it like this, very strange and foreign and far from us, but if somebody sins, if somebody stumbles, if somebody falls, if it happens, it shouldn't be the norm, it should be foreign, it should be weird, it should be odd, it should bring strong conviction unless we become desensitized. My converted ones, my little children, regenerated ones, spirit-filled, saved ones, these things I write to you that you may not sin. But if someone does sin, know this, that we have an advocate with the Father, Yeshua HaMashiach, the righteous.
Amen.
He is now, He Himself, verse 2, is the propitiation for our sins, and not for ours only, but for also the whole world. So He totally forgives our B.C. days. Hallelujah. He will forgive our A.D. days, if you will. Amen. He is the propitiation for our sins. He is our defense lawyer. What He accomplished at the cross was complete, it's finished. Come on, somebody.
Amen.
But our nature is now a new nature.
Yeah.
Hallelujah. It's a godly nature. It's a holy nature. It's a righteous nature. Hallelujah. It's embracing His Lordship nature. It's submitting to the King nature. It's doing what He wants us to do, not what we want to do. nor what he would approve of, what his will is. If we do miss it, make a mistake, call out. He'll forgive. Hallelujah. But we shouldn't be walking in a state of sin's plurality habitually, and we should not be in a stage of rebellion. Those that will not submit to authority, those that will not listen to reason, those that will not obey elders in your life, those that will not obey the word of God, obey the Spirit of the Lord, that's a dangerous place to be because you are doing your own thing. There's a way that seems right to a man, but that way leads to death, to destruction. Your ways are not my ways. Your thoughts are not my thoughts. We have to be spiritually minded, not fleshly, carnally minded. We have to be kingdom minded, not worldly minded. We have to be above and not beneath. We have to be the head and not the tail. We have to be in Christ, and if he's in us, you cannot continually walk in sin. No way, no how. I mean, we can religiously proclaim to be a Christian because that's what they do on Sunday, go to meeting morning. Hallelujah. And then live like the flesh of the devil the rest of the week. Doesn't work that way. Every day. All right, let's stand to our free feet. Hallelujah. Free. Stand up to your feet. Army of God. Come on. Soldiers of the cross. Come on. Let's stand up. Be counted worthy. And live a life that is becoming. Hallelujah. Not unbecoming. That's totally uncivilized. That lifestyle. Is it a radical change?
Yes, it is.
Does it separate us from the shaft? Yes, it does. Does it make you peculiar and strange? Oh, yeah, we're a peculiar people, a very strange people. We don't understand the language of the world anymore because we are foreigners.
Help.
Hallelujah. Ay, Padre, Espíritu Santo. I don't understand that language anymore. I'm a foreigner passing through. I'm from the kingdom of God. Hallelujah. I represent Yeshua HaMashiach. I understand the language he speaks. We understand Hebrew very well, don't we? Hallelujah. Amen.